Welcome back. Do you have any questions or any comments to what we've seen so far? What? Not, let's begin. So what we're going to see now is low-dimensional models of holography. Why go to low dimensions? If our world is four-dimensional, why do we want to go to low dimensions? Well, the main reason is that things become simpler. We have fewer degrees of freedom. The dynamics becomes simpler on both sides of the correspondence. Quantum field theories, conformal field theories in low dimensions, in particular in two dimensions, they have a much larger symmetry than in higher dimensions. And that gives a lot of solvability for many problems. And that's very useful. And you're having the lectures by Matthias, where you're learning everything about two-dimensional conformal field theories. Also, the gravitational side becomes simpler, again, because you have fewer degrees of freedom. Dynamics becomes simpler, and we can solve the Einstein equations much more easily. So today, what I'm going to give you is a few introductory ideas about ADS-CFT in when ADS has two or three dimensions. I will mostly be discussing the gravitational side, and in particular the black holes. This is just the first entry into the field of low-dimensional ADS-CFT. The other sides, I won't be able to. The CFT side in particular, I won't be able to go into much detail, but at least you will see the gravitational side, the black hole side. You will see how we can get black holes, which is something that's not entirely trivial, to obtain black holes in low dimensions. And we will see how, and why, and how. Okay. But let me begin first with something that we saw, which is this idea of reconstructing the bulk metric out of boundary data, which we saw we can do in this what we call the Pfeffermann-Gram expansion, where we parameterize anti-de-Sitter space, or we write it in terms of a coordinate z. So this is the boundary, this is z equals zero, and then we solve the Einstein equations in a perturbative expansion away from the boundary, and the expansion took this form. I'm going to use little l for the ADS radius. I've been using capital L, but I will use capital L later for another purpose. So we choose a particular set of coordinates, what's sometimes called Pfeffermann-Gram gates, which is like Gaussian normal coordinates, where there are the GCC component is fixed and GCI components are set to zero. And then the metric, which here we would have, we have a metric that in general is going to depend on x and z. We expand this in powers of z, and we have a first, usually we would put a superindex here, zero, but I'm going to omit it for simplicity. Using no, let me notation is okay. So we expanded this. There's a first set of terms which correspond to the non-normalizable part of the solution, the source. So all of these terms that I'm putting here are determined uniquely in terms of Gij. This one is not determined in terms of the boundary metric, and this is what corresponds, we saw, corresponds to something that tells you about the state of the field, which is not just specified by this, by the metric of the boundary, so this is not specified, and this gives us information about the interior, okay, about the state in the interior. So then the idea is that, well, given the metric and the stress tensor, you can begin to reconstruct the bulk metric that corresponds to that state. But this expansion in general is an infinite expansion. It's an expansion that doesn't terminate. It goes to arbitrarily high powers of C. So you don't achieve a complete reconstruction of the bulk in this manner. You only get perturbative information. And you may not even get to see things which are at a finite distance in the bulk, some things that might be non-perturbative in C, and you might not get to see that. Okay? But in the case where we have ADS3, that's the case where D equals 2, something miraculous happens. It's not a miracle. We will see later why this happens. But the expansion truncates at a finite order. So you begin to expand, and then at some point, the expansion just doesn't get any more terms. You terminate it exactly. And the way that it terminates, the following. We have this. We have Gij of x. Then we have, this is an expansion in even powers of C. Then so we get the C squared term that's already giving us the part that corresponds to the stress tensor. And then in principle, we might expect to have an infinite series here, but we don't get an infinite series, but a finite one, where let me write it like this. So this is the entire Fermat-Gradle expansion in three dimensions. Okay. Here I'm raising and lowering indices with this metric. As I was saying, this component of the metric gives us the holographic stress tensor, in principle including also the trace anomaly, which is something that's present in two dimensions. And well, the next order is the next order in the expansion that's determined in terms of this stress tensor. Okay. So this is something that looks great because I give you a metric, I give you a stress tensor, two-dimensional metric, two-dimensional stress tensor. This stress tensor, it has to satisfy the condition that it's conserved and that it satisfies the equation of the trace anomaly. And for simplicity, I will be assuming that there is no trace anomaly. So the stress tensor will be zero. We take the metric to be flat. I take Gij to be a flat metric. The trace anomaly is proportional to the curvature, the scalar curvature of the metric. So in that case, the trace anomaly is zero. So if I give you then a flat metric and a stress tensor satisfying these conditions, then you can immediately use this in order to construct a solution to ADS3 gravity that has a dual, that describes a dual theory, with those properties. That the CFT defined on that metric has that stress tensor. Okay? So that looks pretty powerful, this complete bulk reconstruction. And we're going to use it now in order to, well, get some interesting states and reconstruct some bulk solutions that describe an interesting state of the CFT, in particular the thermal state. The dictionary translating between G2 and Tij is that I'm going to remove the brackets just because I want to, well, save a little bit of chalk. So there are factors here. which, if you use this entry in the dictionary, this corresponds to C over 12 pi G2i. Okay. And this is in principle a function of the x coordinates. And it can be any function of the x coordinates as long as it's covariantly conserved and traceless. So, as I said, we can now use this. We can substitute jj with t, and then we get a metric that's entirely specified by the boundary metric and the stress tensor. Put it like this. The expressions, if you just this is work it out with these factors and apply some, it's 8 12 pi over c square. Okay, L. This is squared plus and there's some C squared missing in the notes. I see. Okay, there's this factor missing in the notes if you're following them. But as I say, this is the complete metric specified by CFT data, the metric, the boundary metric, and the stress energy tensor of the metric. Okay. Now I'm going to write this in a something that's very often convenient in two-dimensional theories is to use light cone coordinates. In terms of which the metric I said I'm using a flat metric, and I can put it in Cartesian coordinates, but I can also put it in light cone coordinates. So G plus minus is equal to minus 1/2 the inverse is minus 2. And then if we impose that the stress energy tensor in these coordinates is conserved and traceless, then this means that the stress energy tensor, first of all, it implies that this should be zero. This is the tracelessness condition. This is the trace of the stress tensor. And the two other components, the plus plus component can only depend on x plus, and the minus minus component can only depend on x minus. This ensures that we have a conserved, coherently conserved stress tensor. So I'm going to, this is some function, an arbitrary function of x plus, an arbitrary function of x minus. I'm going to write them so that I absorb some factors of c over 2 pi. So this is an arbitrary function. This is another arbitrary function, x minus. Okay. And in this form, the ADS3 metric that describes an arbitrary state of the CFT, the CFT2, will be so you put here any function new functions L and L bar of X plus and X minus, and this automatically solves, directly solves, the Einstein equations in anti-de-Sitter 3. Okay. So this is a general solution, as long as your boundary metric is flat. One can also generalize it to the case where the boundary metric is not flat. That's something that you can find. I can give you references if you want them. But this is a very useful class of metrics, which sometimes they are called Bañados metrics, because it was Max Bañados who first wrote them in this form. And this L and L bar, you can expand them in Fourier modes. Okay. Like this. Then this L ends, one can prove that they satisfy a Virasoro algebra with the right central touch. I'm not going to do it, but the reason that we're calling them L is because this corresponds to the generators of a Virasoro algebra. Virasoro algebras, you've seen them in Matthias's lectures, and that's one important bit of information in ADS3 CFT2, that you can obtain the Virasoro algebra as well in this manner. I'm not going to do this. What we're going to do with this metric is the following. So if we can construct the bulk metric corresponding to an arbitrary state, well, first of all, we can construct the vacuum. But we can also construct, for instance, one state that we've seen is important and interesting, is the thermal state of the conformal field theory. What is the bulk solution that corresponds to a thermal state of the CFT? We expect this to correspond to a black hole. But we're going to obtain the metric in this way, and then we will see later if this is actually a black hole, and then what black hole it is. What is a thermal state of a conformal field theory? Well, in general, it's going to be a state that has some energy density measured by TT, and it will also have some pressure, because it must be that the stress tensor is zero, and there's no anomaly. So this requires that the II components, diagonal ones, here I'm not summing over I, these are the pressures. So this is pressure, in general, in D dimensions, should satisfy this. So this is a traceless stress energy tensor, because when I sum over all of these, then I get a traceless stress tensor. This is, as I say, the stress tensor of the thermal state of a conformal field theory. And this is something that you may have seen maybe in cosmology. If we set here D equals 4, a four-dimensional conformal thermal state, that corresponds to having P pressure equals rho over 3. And maybe in cosmology, you've seen this as the radiation fluid. Yes? Yeah. So when you apply, when you perform a transformation, a conformal transformation of the boundary metric, then these operators, these are the generators of those transformations. Those symmetry transformations, of the conformal symmetry transformations of the boundary, and they transform in the same way that the Virasoro operators transform. I can give you more details later. Yeah, yes. Okay. So we take this to be some constant. So I say this, in general, it's a radiation fluid or a conformal scale-free fluid. In two dimensions, what we will have is that TTT is going to be the same as the component XX. Okay. The component XX. And we want this to be a constant in order to describe the fluid. So this means that L and L bar will be constants, and I'm going to be, well, this will correspond to the L0 of the L0 mode, the constant mode, the zero mode. And we're going to call this constant mu over 2. So the stress tensor that we have will be C over 24 pi mu. We plug this into the metric, and then what do we get? Plug this in the general form of the metric, and what we find is something that we can write. So here it's in x plus x minus coordinates. I've translated them from x plus x minus to t and x. That's a straightforward exercise. So this, by construction, this is the bulk metric in ADS3 that describes the thermal state of the CFD. Okay. And as I said, we expect this to be a black hole. Can it be a black hole? Well, we have a GTT component. It has a zero, so we expect this to be a horizon. But the structure of this black hole is not very apparent here in this form. We're going to see that it actually corresponds to a black hole that had been already known since the early 90s, a black hole in ADS3. And that's what we're going to discuss now. Okay. Black holes in three dimensions, yes? It's a thermal state because I've taken the stress tensor to be to have this form, to have to be constant energy density. We have a constant energy density, and it's traceless. And that's, in general, what we expect, to have a plasma, if you want, a plasma of the state with constant energy density, with pressure equal to the energy density. And that's what, in general, is the state that corresponds to a state at finite temperature. It's as simple as that. If it looks very simple to you, it's because it's simple. But we're going to see that there's a temperature that we can assign to this. This is something that we haven't seen yet. Okay, I'm telling you that this is finite temperature state, but I'm not telling you what the temperature is. Okay. I'm telling you what the energy density is. You can infer, if you know the energy density, then in general you know for a CFD, well, that if this is some energy density, that you can infer what's the entropy and the temperature, but we're going to do this later when we identify the black hole properly. Okay. So I leave this metric up there. And now what we're going to do is to discuss. I'm going to begin first with some general observations about gravity in three dimensions and about black holes in three dimensions. Because gravity in three dimensions, so a very peculiar theory, Einstein gravity in three dimensions. So I said when you go to lower dimensions, your theory simplifies, but it may seem also that it simplifies too much. Because the first thing that you find when you want to say study vacuum gravity in three dimensions, there are no black holes. So you simplify the thing too much. You wanted to simplify the dynamics, but as they say, you threw the baby out with the water. The baby here were the black holes. There are no black holes, black hole solutions to these equations. And why is this? Well, it's a very simple reason. There's a very simple reason why you don't have black holes in, say, there's no generalization of the Schwarzschild solution to three dimensions. To higher dimensions, there is. There's a Schwarzschild solution in 4, 5, 6, and it looks very similar to the three-dimensional one. But in three dimensions, there isn't. And the reason, as I say, it's simple, is the following. Three dimensions, say that we're setting the speed of light to 1, but then the classical theory, you have G Newton in order to translate between matter and geometry, to convert energy scales or mass scales into distances. In four dimensions, GM has dimensions of length. If you're in more than four dimensions, the quantity that has dimensions of length, we're going to use capital D. Okay? Capital D is the dimension of the space-time. In D larger than 4, D equals or larger than 4, this is something that has dimensions of length. Okay? And we just have G and speed of light. There's no H bar anywhere here. I'm not setting, this is purely classical. So this is length, and this is what sets the radius for the Schwarzschild black hole in higher dimensions, with some numerical factor, 2 or something that depends on the number of dimensions. So this is, I give you a mass, and then I tell you, well, there's a length scale in the problem, and this length scale tells you where the horizon is going to be. You need a length scale. Given a mass, you assign it a length scale, and that's going to correspond to the horizon radius, or at least set the scale for the horizon radius. But when d equals 4, this breaks down, obviously. Why? Because in d equals 4, in d equals 3. In d equals 3, this is dimensionless. This is just a pure number. It doesn't set any scale. So if I give you a mass in three dimensions, and then you want to see, well, can there be a horizon associated to this mass? No, there cannot be any horizon, because there's no length scale associated to this. So what happens when you put a mass, when you try to solve, say, the Schwarzschild problem in three dimensions, that you try to find the spherically symmetric, in this case, circularly symmetric field that has some given mass? Well, what you find is not a horizon. You find a quantity that's characterized not by a length, but by a dimensionless number, which is a conical angle. A mass in three dimensions, what it creates is a conical deficit. You put a mass in three dimensions, and then what you're doing is removing a wedge from your spacetime. You identify this, you get a cone. Okay? So a mass in three dimensions is not a black hole. A mass in three dimensions, a point mass, in this case, there's a sense to a point mass in three dimensions, that creates a conical deficit. And the conical deficit is characterized by an angle, and that's something that's dimensionless. Okay? So this is why there are no black holes, black hole solutions to these equations. Okay? Because there's no scale, no length scale set by the mass that would tell you the size of the horizon. The mass, by the way, I mean, the larger the mass, the larger the conical deficit. Okay? So the mass is measured, it's proportional to the conical deficit angle. So, well, we went to three dimensions trying to simplify our life to make our gravitational model more solvable, but we looks like we oversimplified. We've lost the black holes. But then how can we recover black holes in three dimensions? If we want to recover a black hole, then what we have to do is introduce some length scale again. I mean, there wasn't any length scale. Let's introduce some length scale in the problem and see whether we can recover a black hole. How can we reintroduce a length scale? Well, we can introduce a cosmological constant. So we have a cosmological constant. The cosmological constant has dimensions of 1 over length squared. So maybe, if not these equations, maybe the equations of the Einstein equations coupled to a cosmological constant, maybe these equations will have a black hole. But just having a length scale is not enough to give you a black hole. You need something else. You need attraction. Okay? The black hole should be attractive. So if you introduce a positive cosmological constant, you get a horizon, but not a black hole horizon. What you get is a cosmological horizon. You can get the Sitter space in two dimensions, and that has a horizon set by the cosmological radius. But, as I say, that's not a black hole, that's a cosmology. Now, say that instead of, so this, putting a positive cosmological constant doesn't work, but maybe putting a negative cosmological constant will work. Why? Because when we have a negative cosmological constant, we have the opposite effect of the expansion. Positive cosmological constant gives us expansion, accelerated expansion, the Sitter expansion. A negative cosmological constant will give us a tendency to collapse. And that's good. So maybe if we introduce a negative cosmological constant, we get a length scale, and then we also get tendency to collapse. this begins to smell like a black hole. And then what it does, it does work. The only thing that, the one thing that you have to bear in mind is that according to this reasoning, the black holes that we're going to get in three dimensions, they're going to have their size determined by the cosmological radius. So just like we saw before that we have in ADS, in higher dimensions, we have black holes which are much smaller than the cosmological radius, or black holes with a size that's proportional to the cosmological radius, and those were large black holes, what we call large ADS black holes. All the black holes that we can get in three dimensions are going to be large black holes determined by the cosmological radius. We won't have small black holes which are parametrically smaller than the cosmological radius, because those would, in a limit, they would look like flat black holes, and those don't exist as in terms of flat black holes. Okay, so we're going to get black holes. We're going to have black holes with a negative cosmological constant, but black holes of a size comparable to the ADS radius, or at least given by the scale of the ADS radius. Okay. So the problem, we're going to see how this works. But then, well, we have to solve the equations. We have to solve the Einstein equations in the 3D sitter. And this is a task that's actually fairly easy, because gravity in three dimensions, just pure gravity, or gravity with a cosmological constant, without any matter, that's a very simple theory. Gravity in three dimensions doesn't have any gravitational waves. There are no propagating degrees of freedom. Okay. So that's another simplification. That's independent of the absence of black holes. The absence of black holes, as I say, is something that just follows from dimensional arguments. For this theory, the absence of black holes is not directly related to the absence of degrees of freedom. Actually, when we introduce the cosmological constant, we can have black holes, but there is still no gravitational waves. So why is it that in three dimensions, gravity doesn't have any local degrees of freedom? Well, there's several different ways of seeing this. That, I'm going to write it here. 3D gravity has no propagating degrees of freedom. Okay. This is a fact that follows from pure geometry. The Weyl tensor in 3D vanishes identically. The Weyl tensor, you know that it's the part of the Riemann tensor, of the curvature tensor. It's the part of the curvature tensor that is not determined by the Ricci tensor. You know that you can take the Riemann tensor. Riemann is this tensor with four dimensions. You can take traces. The trace of the Riemann tensor gives you Ricci. But Ricci is determined, is fixed by the Einstein equations. So Ricci is fixed by matter or by the absence of matter. What is not fixed by the equations is the Weyl tensor. This corresponds to the things that vary, that can propagate, that make solutions different from each other. Okay. So two solutions of the Einstein equations, say in four dimensions, the vacuum Einstein equations, they differ in mostly in the Weyl tensor. Okay. Because the Ricci tensor in vacuum, it would be zero. Solutions differ in the Weyl tensor, so that's kind of the free content, the degrees of freedom of the Einstein equations, the Weyl tensor. And actually, for people who study gravitational waves, they extract the gravitational waves by measuring the Weyl tensor at infinity. Components of the Weyl tensor, one decomposes it in an appropriate way, and the Weyl tensor at infinity is the way to measure the gravitational waves that are propagating. But gravitational waves have non-zero Weyl tensor, even if they are solutions of Rij equals zero. Okay. And this is, as I said, this is in three dimensions, this is a mathematical identity. Something that applies to any 3D geometry. Okay. There's another way to see, and I think that we mentioned it, that in 2 plus 1 dimensions you cannot have gravitational waves. And it is simply that you don't have room for having quadrupolar motion. You remember this, we saw it in the. You need a. If a gravitational wave is propagating in this direction, then it distorts matter on planes transverse to the propagating direction. It distorts, say, a ball of or a circle of particles. It makes it move in a shearing way. But then if you just have one direction, I mean, there's only one, there's the propagation direction, and there's only another direction, spatial direction, which is transverse to the axis of propagation, then, well, things can only move up and down. This allows for dipolar motion, but not for quadrupolar motion. And gravitational waves induce quadrupolar motion. So that's kind of a more pedestrian way of seeing that there can't be any gravitational waves in 2 plus 1. So we have that the Weyl tensor is zero. Nevertheless, well, you know that in higher dimensions, the Weyl tensor, if it's zero, this means that the metric, a metric in four or more dimensions that has vanishing Weyl tensor, is a metric that's conformally flat. This doesn't happen in three dimensions. In three dimensions, the way to distinguish whether a metric is conformally flat or not is to use a different quantity, something that's called the Cotton tensor. Cotton, by the way, was French. It's not cotton, but cotton. So what we have is that in three dimensions, the Riemann tensor is fully determined by the Ricci tensor, okay? Because the Weyl tensor is zero. Now, if we have a cosmological constant, the equations that we want to solve are okay. With a cosmological constant and nothing else, the Einstein equations are these equations. So the Ricci tensor is determined by the metric, has to be proportional to the metric, and since in three dimensions the Riemann tensor is determined by the Ricci tensor, because there's no Weyl component, then the Riemann tensor is fully given by the metric. So this means, since this implies that the Ricci tensor is constant, that's proportional to the metric, the Ricci tensor is constant, so the Riemann tensor must be constant. That's to say that you can write it as some constant proportional to the combination of the metric that has the appropriate symmetries. Okay. So the curvature, Riemann curvature of solutions of these equations, the curvature will be constant. So all your solutions to these equations will have constant Riemann curvature, which means that they are all going to be locally equivalent to anti-de Sitter space in three dimensions. Anti-de Sitter space is this hyperboloid with constant curvature. So all the solutions to these equations will be at least locally equivalent to anti-de Sitter 3. There may be global differences because these equations only tell us about the local structure, but all solutions are locally equivalent to anti-de Sitter 3. So this may look bad because we wanted to find black holes, and then I'm telling you that all the solutions are like ADS3. So where are my black holes? Well, the black holes will appear, and non-trivial solutions will appear, because even if they are locally, all of them equivalent, globally there will be differences. And these differences are what will be responsible for the appearance of horizons and other properties. Okay? So let's construct metrics that are ADS3, but in which we can analyze we can change the global properties. We already saw this. We saw that we can begin with the hyperboloidal embeddings. So you remember that a few days ago, we constructed anti-de Sitter space as a particular surface in this spacetime, just like we can build a sphere as the constant radio surface in one more dimension. And the anti-de Sitter 3 with a unit curvature radius is this surface embedded in this spacetime. So you remember that we flipped a few signs from the sphere. We flipped the signs twice, one of them to have negative constant curvature instead of positive constant curvature, and the other flip of signs was because we want to have time instead of just a Euclidean manifold. And we saw that we can choose coordinates that solve this, the surface constraint equation. If we choose here, say that I write this like this, and then I choose coordinates here, polar coordinates, TR, and here I choose another set of polar coordinates, which are going to be R and phi. R is going to be the same so that we satisfy the equations. We choose here X2 equals R cosine phi, X3 R sine phi. So this parameterizes this plane. Then if we want to have that this is satisfied, then X0 and X1 okay. So with this choice of coordinates, we're solving this explicitly. We plug this in the metric above, and we find this solution that should already be very familiar to you. Which is what we call global anti-de-Sitter space in three dimensions. Okay. So this is global ADS3. Explicitly, you remember that we made this coordinate, which in principle here it looks like it should be periodic, but we unwrapped it to avoid closed time-like curves and to have time running from minus infinity to infinity. Now this phi, this is a polar angle in the plane, so normally we will take it to be periodic with periodicity 2 pi, but we can also do something else. We can do a different global an identification that changes the global structure of the spacetime. If we take this to be some arbitrary period, delta phi, then, well, what we're going to get here, if we identify not under a turn of 2 pi, but we identify after turning an angle delta phi, then, in general, this is going to be a conical singularity in ADS3. And this will correspond to a massive particle in anti-de-Sitter space. Just like we saw that a massive particle in flat space corresponds to a conical deficit, a conical angle, we want this to be a deficit if we want the mass to be positive. Then in this case, we can also get in anti-de-Sitter space. So you go close to R equals zero, where things look flat, and then that's going to look like a particle, a conical angle. It's going to differ at larger distances. So this is the way that we describe the metric of a particle, a point particle in anti-de-Sitter 3. But we don't have any horizon yet. GTT here is always non-zero. So we don't have a black hole. How do we get a black hole here? In order to get a black hole, what we're going to do is choose a different set of coordinates on this. So we have this surface in the same space-time. And now what I'm going to do is pair the coordinates in a different way. I'm going to pair this coordinate with this one and this one with this one. And here we have a minus sign and a plus sign. So this looks like Lorentzian. So we can choose, what we're going to do is choose boost coordinates on these planes. These are Lorentzian planes. We take boost coordinates, just to say that we choose x1 equals, instead of circular functions, we take hyperbolic functions. And so these are the boost parameters, phi and tau and t. Now, if we plug this here, this is satisfied identically, so this solves the constraint, and then we can take this change of coordinates, insert it here, and the metric that we find is this one. Okay. So this begins to look good, because it looks like we can have a horizon here now. Why do we get this? Well, first of all, you must notice that here, since these are boost coordinates, in principle, we can have them running from minus infinity to infinity. Okay. This is, again, anti de Sitter space. It's always anti de Sitter space, but now written in other coordinates. We have just chosen a different set of coordinates. But now these are not global coordinates. As you see, we have a horizon that's limiting the range of validity of these coordinates. The coordinates break down at r equals 1, where this metric component diverges. Okay. So what we're doing here is we have anti de Sitter space. What we're doing here is choosing what's called Rindler coordinates, accelerated coordinates. This t, now it's not the same time as we have here. It's a different coordinate. We have here t running vertically. Here, trajectories of generated by the Killing vector dt, they are trajectories like this. This is a trajectory of r equals constant and phi constant. Okay? So t now runs here. T is a boost coordinate. So these are what's known as Rindler coordinates, but in anti de Sitter space. These are coordinates which are adapted to trajectories of observers that follow trajectories of uniform acceleration. So we call this Rindler ADS3. Rindler space, by the way, is the space that in two dimensions, or let's say in flat space, in Minkowski space in any number of dimensions. These are coordinates that don't cover all of the Minkowski space, but are adapted to trajectories of observers with uniform acceleration. Rindler coordinates for Minkowski space in two dimensions are like this. R equals 0 corresponds to this horizon, where this thing vanishes, and trajectories of constant r are hyperbolas, and you know that hyperbolas are trajectories of uniform acceleration. Okay. And you can easily verify that if you go close to r equals 1, the metric can be written in a form that's, you would put maybe here some other coordinate, x, that corresponds to the distance away from r equals 0. I'm not doing this. This is something that you've probably seen, and there's more details in the notes. So this is what we call Rindler ADS3, which is, again, it's just another form, another patch of anti de Sitter space. But it's still the same space as anti de Sitter 3. It's only that we're choosing coordinates that only cover part of it in a funny way. Okay, so these are coordinates that are just the coordinates that somebody who's moving with uniform acceleration would be using. But it's the same space. Okay. How can we make this into something that's a black hole? Well, here you see that we have a horizon. What is the area of this horizon? The horizon is at r equals 1. R equals 1 or r equals minus 1, but let's say that we take r equals 1. What is the area of the horizon? Well, the area of the horizon, in this case, is the length of this coordinate. So the area, I'm going to call it an area, but of course in 2 plus 1 dimensions, this is just a length. This is the integral of d phi at r plus, this is r plus equals 1. And the integral runs from minus infinity to plus infinity. So the area of this horizon is infinite. And that's a property of acceleration horizons. Acceleration horizons, which you can have in flat space, are horizons that have infinite area. So here what you have is that, well, this is an acceleration horizon of infinite area. Infinite area is something that we don't want for a black hole. We want the area of the black hole to be finite. How do we make the area of the black hole finite? Well, by just declaring that it's finite. How do we do this? Well, instead of having phi running from minus infinity to plus infinity, I have phi running from zero to some period that I choose to be whatever I want. Okay, so phi now runs from zero to delta phi. Delta phi is just some number that I choose. What this is saying is that I'm identifying along the orbits of the boost generator. So this is a boost, and then there's a killing vector, partial phi, that's the one that generates translations in phi. I'm saying that the orbits, the trajectories generated by this vector, instead of being infinite, I'm making them periodic, identifying. So that's like, instead of having a line, I'm identifying points along a line with a periodicity. And of course, when I do this with a real line, what I get is a circle. Okay. So I'm changing, by doing this, I'm changing the global properties of the spacetime. The circle and the line locally are the same, but globally they are different. Because in the circle, you come back to the same point after a full turn. Okay. So if I do this, this geometry, it's going to be, again, anti-Sitter's theory locally, but globally it's different. Globally it's different because by this identification, I've changed the global properties of the spacetime. And now I've made this horizon into a finite area horizon. Okay? So the two solutions, anti-Sitter space and this one, they are locally equivalent, but globally different. This is a black hole that we obtain after taking Rindler AdS3, which is the same as anti-Sitter 3, only covering a partial patch. What differs is that now in this Rindler AdS3, we change the global structure by taking these boost directions to be periodic. And we don't have, in principle, any conical singularity here, because there's no fixed point for the vector d by d phi. There's some things that one gets by performing this identification that will happen in the interior of the black hole, like, for instance, the fact that there are time machines inside this black hole. But I'm not going to go into that because we're only going to look at the exterior of the black hole, not the interior. That's because if you perform identifications along a boost, there are regions where it's space-like, there are regions where it's time-like. When you perform identifications along a time-like direction, this means that you're generating closed time-like curves. But as I say, that's something that's not going to be important for what we say here. Well, this geometry that we get in this manner, by starting with anti-de Sitter 3 and identifying points. What we're doing is, I give you anti-Sitter 3 and I tell you, I'm identifying this point with this point, with this point, with this point. I'm doing this using explicit coordinates, but I could do it in a completely coordinate independent way. Okay? I could describe my killing vectors, my symmetries, and then I say what I'm doing is I'm taking a quotient along the orbits of some isometries. That's kind of the fancy mathematical way of saying what I'm doing. I have some isometries generated by this killing vector generates isometries, and then I'm identifying points along orbits of this isometry. If you want, I'm taking a quotient of anti-de Sitter 3 by a discrete group. And that gives me that geometry over there with this identification, which is what we call the BTC black hole, or Bañados, Teitelbaum, and Sanelli, who are the, yes.
Is this just an identification of points?
Yes.
Or are you compactifying one of the directions?
It's the same thing.
Ah, it's the same.
Oh, okay. Yes. So it's identification. So you see, I mean, at least it's the same thing if you consider. If I tell you that I'm identifying points along a line, then I can equivalently say that what I'm doing is I'm compactifying the line into a circle. Okay, so that's the reason that I'm saying that is the same thing. Identifying points. If you want, this is the method of images description of the circle.
So you're I'm changing the topology by performing the identifications, which is to say that I'm compactifying the direction file. Yeah, I would use two expressions as equivalent without even stopping to think about it, but it's good that you mention it because it's kind of. Yes. So that's a good question. This black hole won't have any curvature singularity because the curvature is constant everywhere. So the curvature doesn't blow up anywhere. So this black hole does not have any curvature singularity. Does it have a singularity in some sense? Yes, it does, but it's a singularity that appears because of global issues. So if you study this in more detail, then you see that there are some geodesics in this spacetime, some null geodesics, which are incomplete. I'm not going to discuss this. I can give you more details if you want separately. But there are, so one way of defining a singularity is in terms of geodesic incompleteness, that there are geodesics that terminate at finite parameter, at finite affine time, or finite affine parameter. And this is something that happens in the interior of the black hole, at r equals zero, actually. Okay? That's not a space-like singularity, it's a null singularity. Not all geodesics terminate there. So there are some geodesics that continue across that surface. You can also continue the metric across that surface. You can perform a maximal analytical extension across the surface. So it's a very mild singularity. So what sometimes one calls a quasi-regular singularity or a quasi-regular surface. Okay. And at the other side of this surface, there are time machines. So there are closed time like curves. Okay. So the Penrose diagram, if you just, so in Penrose diagrams, we just take a two-dimensional, I mean, we take the T and R components. So the nature of the singularity will be misleading. So we have R going to infinity is asymptotic because this metric, when R goes to infinity, it looks like anti de Sitter 3. But now we have, this is going to be R equals 1, and I'm going to, for now, our horizon is at R equals 1. We're going to see how it can change to other values. So these are null surfaces. It's just like what we drew before when we drew the Rindler ADS3, and this is what we're getting here. But now, R equals 0. Here it looks like space-like, but it's actually null. And we can see that it's null because it's the point where that boost becomes null. So that's not well reflected because there's another direction, the direction phi. In the direction phi, this is null. It's not easy to picture, okay? But it's what it is. So this is R equals zero, okay? And that's, as I say, it's a very mild singularity. It's not a curvature singularity. It's a singularity where some geodesics become incomplete. And we usually cut it here if we want to describe this as a black hole. Also because, well, you may say, how do I get rid of the region where there are closed time-like curves? Well, I just declare that my space here ends here and I can't go into the other region. So that's cutting off the geometry brutally. But, well, that's a choice that you can have. But it's a black hole also because this now has, we call it a black hole because it has first this causal structure and also because it has a horizon with finite area. Which is what we didn't have in the case of Rindler ADS3. In the case of Rindler ADS3, we had an infinite acceleration horizon. Now this becomes a horizon of a finite area that corresponds to the area of these surfaces. So the area now is going to be the area of the horizon is going to be this delta phi. Okay. Now, that form of writing the BTC metric, that's not what we would usually call the canonical form of the metric. Why? Because we usually like our angles to have periodicity. If it's going to be a circular angle, we want the angle to be to have periodicity 2 pi. How do we solve this? Well, it's very easy. We introduce a new angular coordinate, phi tilde, defined in such a way we just rescale the angle by this factor. Now the periodicity of phi is 2 pi, simply rescaling. I mean, if we had the periodicity of the angle was delta phi, we divide it by a factor so that now the periodicity is 2 pi, and we like our circular angles to have periodicity 2 pi. We also rescale the other coordinates so that we get a metric in a slightly nicer form. Introduce coordinates r tilde and t tilde. This is a rescaling, okay? I'm not doing anything to the metric. I'm just choosing slightly different coordinates. But globally, the metric is the same as I've done there when I identified it in this form. Well, the metric then becomes writing here something that I'm going to explain what this is. Where now this looks like the conventional angular part because phi, this phi now has periodicity to 2 pi. What is this 8gm? Well, this 8gm is the same as delta phi, but I'm using different notation. Simply delta phi divided by 2 pi squared. Okay. So we change, the only thing that we've done to the geometry, the ASTS geometry, is introduce this periodicity. And what we're going to say is that this periodicity actually corresponds to the mass of the black hole. In order to see this, there are different ways. You can perform a canonical analysis, Hamiltonian analysis of this metric in general relativity to define the mass using canonical methods to define the mass. And then you see that actually the mass of this spacetime is given by this expression, or that the mass corresponds to this constant term in the metric. So that's something that BTC did, this canonical analysis. But we're going to compute the mass in a different way. We're going to compute it from the holographic stress tensor. Because now what we're going to see is that that metric over there and that metric over there, or if you want this metric and that metric, they are the same. So we're now coming to our starting point. We said that that metric should be a black hole in antisitter 3. Now we have found a black hole in antisitter 3. We're going to see that they are the same. What is the way to see that they are the same? There's many different ways, but the simplest one is to just find what is the coordinate change between one and the other. Okay. Yes? It's not wrong. Yeah, you can say that. It's the planar black hole in three dimensions. It's, yeah. Would I say that? Yeah. Yeah, that's when you take the mass to be very large, so the periodicity becomes infinitely large, so you can say that. Anything else? Any more questions? So we're coming back to this metric. I want to see that this and this are the same. Well, we have to identify parameters. So we have here mu, and then this is an exercise that you can perform. Identify this. Well, by the way, what's the simplest way of seeing that these two metrics are the same? Well, one thing that we're going to do is to make this x into an angle that's periodic, because otherwise this is just going to be Rindler ADS3. But we want x to be phi. Then how do I identify the coordinates r tilde and z? Well, we require that the coefficient in terms of dx squared, which is d phi squared, if we call this r squared, then we're essentially done. So what we do is we take r tilde to be 1 over c, 1 plus mu over 4 c squared. If we do this identification, this will become, with this c over here, let me set this to 1. So this will become r squared, tilde r squared, and then the rest of the things will follow. And you actually find, let me see, we also have to identify t tilde equals t. It's very simple, we got it in the right coordinates already. We have then x identified with periodicity 2 pi. You do the change of coordinates, and then what do you get? Exactly this, with this identification of mu with 8gm. Okay. Which is nice, because we said that the mu was related to the energy density, and that's something that we're going to see now, that it gives us the correct mass. So this was a black hole, and it's actually the BTC black hole. What we had from the CFT before, so we had L was equal to L tilde, which was mu over 2. Okay. This is what we chose before. This means that L plus L tilde, which in the CFT will correspond to the mass, the difference between them we'll mention, but we want to do in detail, will correspond to the spin, which we haven't introduced yet. So this is 8gm, and L minus L bar is 0, as I'm saying. So then, this is telling us that now we can, you see, it was already there. T plus plus was C over 24 pi times mu. Same thing was T my minus, minus, minus. So TTT is mu. Mu is this quantity. So this is 8gm multiplied by C over 24 pi. We use that C over, C is 3 over 2g. So we're translating now CFT quantities into gravitational quantities. So this is 1 over 2 pi m, which is what we wanted, because we want the energy is the integral of the energy density. So yes, the identification here was correct. We could have done it the other way around, I mean, without revealing here that this is going to be the mass, but what we're doing is checking that it works out correctly. Okay. So good. So then that bulk reconstruction, it worked the right way. It gave us a black hole with the right properties. And then out of this black hole, we can compute what's the temperature. You can see that it's a thermal state. So it works well. Okay. Yes. Again, it's that you want to have a finite mass, for instance. If x runs from 0 to infinity, then you would have something else. If you identified it with a periodicity different than 2 pi, then all of the quantities, because here the definitions are all assuming, that's something that I didn't say, but they are all assuming that the periodicity is 2 pi. If you rescale quantities in your CFT, then if you rescale the length of the circle, then all quantities get, because it's conformal, they get automatically rescaled by that same factor. So it was implicit in what I was saying for the thermal state. It was implicit when I was using these formulas. It was implicit that x had periodicity 2 pi. Yeah? I didn't say that. So this should be a circle of periodicity 2 pi. If you take a different periodicity, then the energy density will rescale if you keep the mass fixed, or well, depending, you can rescale one thing or the other. But everything will rescale according to the conformal, to the scale invariance of the problem. Okay. So yeah, that's actually a point that I should have emphasized, that here, when I was doing the CFT analysis and describing the thermal state, I was taking the thermal state on a circle of length 2 pi. I could make the circle of a length L, and then I would have to insert factors of L everywhere in a way that's automatic, just fixed by dimensional arguments. Okay, so it works well, but then there are some, here's some things that may look a little surprising. First, so we have this general class of metrics, BTC metrics. We can get global anti-de Sitter space, global ADS, This would correspond to making this quantity equal to 1. So if we set, then this metric becomes the same as global ADS, that one over there. Okay, so that one up there, you see that if we set this to 1, this becomes a global ADS. Now this global ADS tree, then I'm telling you that it has a mass, well, 1 minus 8 over e. It has negative mass. What is this? Have we seen this before? Yes, that's the Casimir energy that of the CFT. Okay? So again, we recover everything consistently. Okay, so global ADS3 has a mass below 0. The state with m equals 0, that's the zero mass black hole. That's what corresponds to Poincaré ADS3 with identifications. These identifications introduce, again, some mild singularities. They are null orbifold singularities, which are not curvature singularities, but the space is mildly singular. Okay? So the m equals 0 state. And then between, in this range, what we get, so there's a range of negative masses. This is the range where we get conical singularities in ADS3. So this is global ADS3. We're putting some mass. If we put some mass in ADS3, we're raising the mass. We get these conical particles with finite mass in ADS3. We begin to increase more and more the mass, and then at one point, we find that what we're creating is black holes. So the spectrum that we have here in ADS3 is a spectrum. First, it's a discrete gap from the global state to the black hole states. That's filled in by conical singularities, by particles. And then for positive masses, we get a spectrum of black holes with large entropy. Now, I'll finish now with ADS3 by saying on the BTC black hole that you can add rotation to the BTC black hole. What you do is instead of taking, we obtained it by making identifications under orbits of a boost vector. You have other isometries in ADS3. After all, it's a maximally symmetric spacetime, so you have a lot of symmetry, and then you can choose under which isometries you perform identifications. So say if we perform identifications under a boost, then that's BTC. And I don't need to know any coordinates. So for instance, whenever, if you give me an antidesiter, a metric in antidesiter 3, and then you tell me, well, is this a black hole or what is it? But then everything that I have to do is to look at which, whether there are identifications of points. If I can find that in your geometry, the geometry that you're giving me, there are identifications along a boost orbit, then I know that there must exist some way of changing the coordinates between the ones that you're using and other coordinates, because the spacetimes are globally the same, locally the same, and globally the same, so they must be the same. Okay, so this is a global definition of the black hole that's actually independent of the coordinates. You define it according to identifications of points. Now you can choose different identifications. If you combine identifications under a boost and under a rotation, ADS3, there we're identifying along rotations. So if you combine the two, identifications under, you combine under a linear combination of a boost vector and a rotational vector, then you get a geometry that corresponds to a rotating black hole, the rotating BTC black hole. Okay, so that's globally different. You're performing a different identification, and that gives rotational properties to the spacetime. I'm not going to describe it, something in the notes, and you can go also go to the paper that Bañados, Eno, Teitelbaum, and Sanelli wrote in 93, which is, I think it's a fantastic paper, where they describe all of these constructions. So in that case, you can see that that geometry with those identifications corresponds to a rotating black hole. In that case, there's not even that singularity. In that case, the identifications don't introduce even global singularities. So the spacetime is geodesically complete. There are CTCs, like there are, they often appear in rotating black holes, in the interior of rotating black holes. So that has, again, time machines. And that's, well, one of the solutions, this rotating BTC black hole. It's a solution that describes, at least in this sense, the most general black hole that you can get in anti-de-Sitter 3, unless you do other dirty things to the geometry. Okay, and that those black holes appear as dual to two-dimensional CFTs. What does the rotation of the BTC black hole correspond to? Well, rotation means that there's going to be motion along the direction x, so that corresponds to momentum along the direction of the circle in the CFT2. So states of a CFT2 which are thermal but with momentum, they are moving along the direction of the circle, those are dual to a rotating black hole. Okay. The time that we have remaining for this lecture, we're going to go to two dimensions. But before we leave two dimensions, do you have any questions about 3D? Yes. That it's a thermal state. In the CFT side, well, because the stress tensor of a CFT, whenever you have a stress tensor that has constant energy density, that's a thermal state of the CFT. You can verify, if you want, that these correlation functions here will satisfy the KMS condition of periodicity in imaginary time. I don't see. Well, there's different ways of doing this. Probably you go Euclidean and then you see how this is related by a conformal transformation to the vacuum. Everything is conformal transformations here in 2D. So you can see, yes, you go Euclidean, and then you will see that you have a periodicity in Euclidean time. That you can obtain it from a transformation that induces periodicity in Euclidean time. Yes?
Are there any examples of bulk spacetimes where L and L bar are functions of
X? Yes. You can construct them yourself. Yes. But of course, you want to have the geometry to have some nice properties. But yeah, it's possible to construct. It's not difficult. I mean, and as I say, you just choose it. Any function of x plus and x minus that you choose there, that's going to correspond to some non-trivial state of the CFT, and then you can reconstruct the bulk and analyze it. It's a game that, for instance, I played in order to study time machines in two dimensions. Yes. Yes, so
but
that's also present here.
There is no such normal ordering
application. So the central charge, as I said, you obtain it from the symmetry of asymptotic. So you fix your asymptotic metric. There's a group of transformations that preserve the asymptotic form of the metric, so these are the asymptotic symmetries, and then you study how these quantities transform under the asymptotic group of symmetries. Those correspond to conformal transformations in the CFT, and you know that the Virasoro, that the stress tensor, if you want, you can work directly with the stress tensor. The stress tensor under a conformal symmetry, it transforms first as in the usual way, non-anomalous way, and you have just the scaling properties. And then in the transformation, there's a part that's the anomalous part that's proportional to the central charge. So you study just coordinate transformations in the bulk. You see, you perform some coordinate transformation here in the bulk, and then you see how this is acting at the boundary, preserving boundary conditions, the boundary conditions that you impose. Then you see how the stress tensor transform under these coordinates, these coordinate transformations. And then you see that the stress tensor transforms in the usual way that it would transform under as a rescaling, because it's a quantity that has a dimension 2. But then there's an anomalous part in the transformation. The anomalous part that's proportional to the central charge, and that's the way that you see it. The way from the transformation of the stress tensor under bulk transformations that at the boundary correspond to conformal transformations. I don't know if I've explained it in a clear way, but it's all the, so there's a set of bulk coordinate transformations Some of them are just pure gauge transformations, but you know that whenever you have coordinate transformations, there are large gauge transformations, which are physical, they act physically at the boundary, and then there are the, you want small gauge transformations, those are the ones which are pure gauge, that don't act on the space of states. Large gauge transformations act on the space of states. That's something that we also have here. So there are some transformations that act at the boundary as conformal rescalings of the boundary metric, or conformal transformation of the boundary metric. I perform a change of coordinates from x plus minus c to x plus minus prime c prime. I perform a coordinate transformation parameterized by some functions. Then I see how these act when I go to the boundary. I choose the ones that act as conformal transformations, conformal changes of the boundary metric. And then I see how these transformations act on quantities that I define in the bulk. Because this TT, this corresponds essentially to this part of the metric. This coordinate transformation is going to change this. Then I see how this quantity here changes. That gives me the transformation of the stress tensor. I see how it transforms. Part of it is a non-anomalous transformation, and the rest is the anomalous part, is the one that gives me the central charge. Have I replied to your question? Maybe not. More or less, but yes. Anything else? So three dimensions is disposed of. Let's go to two dimensions. Maybe I won't get too far, but I will say some things, at least some general things about 2D gravity. Yes?
Can I have a light bulb from collapsing
in 3D? That's a good question. So first, you want to add matter. And then you can do this with shells, for instance. That's a very simple way of doing it with shells. And then you can start with a shell geometry that the exterior is ADS3 in some form, the interior is ADS3 in a different form. You glue them at the gluing surface. You get some shell, some stress tensor. You can make it collapse and form a BTC black hole. That's one way of doing it. Another way, which can also be done in a fully algebraic way, because everything, all of this is just performing different identifications between points. So one way, one thing that you can do is to take two conical deficits in ADS3, which you can describe again in a fully algebraic way. Then you throw them at each other with, say, head-on, with some energy. And then you can see that at some point, these, when they collide, they perform a transition to a BTC black hole. All of this is just a purely algebraic way of describing the formation of the black hole. The topology of the solution changes when the two conical deficits meet and they create a black hole horizon. That's one way of doing it. So it's possible to do it, yes. Possible to do it, and as I say, without solving the Einstein equations at any moment. Why is your life so simple here? Because you don't have gravitational waves. Gravitational waves are this thing that complicates your life so much. I mean, who wants gravitational waves? If they are just some nuisance that you have when you want to describe your black holes, okay? If you can get rid of gravitational waves, then you're happy. You can study just your black holes without those silly fluctuations over there. Of course, I'm kidding, you know. Gravitational waves are great, but they make things more complicated. Well, making things complicated, making your life complicated is always good. But sometimes you want to make it simpler. Okay. So, 2D gravity. There's another way, something that I'm not saying anything about. There's another way of decoupling gravitational waves from the black hole, which doesn't involve going to low dimensions. It involves precisely the opposite limit. If you take the number of dimensions to be very, very large, and then, well, you say, well, how large can I get them? I take them to infinity. Then that's another way of decoupling gravitational waves from the black hole. And that also simplifies a lot the study of your black hole. But that would be a different set of lectures. So 2D gravity, so in 3D, we saw that we had that the Weyl tensor was zero. There are no propagating degrees of freedom. And then all solutions to the Einstein equations were solutions where the Riemann tensor was constant. Okay. Now in two dimensions, so in three dimensions, we had that the Weyl tensor was identically zero. What do we have, what do we get when we go to D equals two? Well, it's even simpler because in two dimensions, this is an identity. This is always satisfied. And then you say, well, that's great. So I'm solving the Einstein equations always without doing anything. Well, it's great, but you don't seem to get too much out of that, right? So there are no solutions. We can't find any solutions to these equations other than trivial ones because there are no equations. The Einstein equations are no equations to solve. They are satisfied identically. Okay. That's just another way of saying, or one manifestation of the fact that the Einstein-Hilbert action in two dimensions that this is a topological invariant. Okay. So you just specify the topology of your space, and it's the same for all different metrics that you put on that space. So if this were Euclidean, you take your metric to be, or your space to be a sphere. You put any metric that you want on the sphere. This quantity is the same for all of them. So the variation of this, usually we get the Einstein equations out by variation of the action. The variation of this, the bulk variation gives us nothing, and the only thing that we get is boundary terms. Okay. So all the interesting dynamics would be at the boundary, if there's any dynamics. But we want to have non-trivial equations. We want to solve equations, okay? After all, because we want to find different solutions. This doesn't mean we're going to have equations, but this doesn't mean that we're going to introduce propagating degrees of freedom. Okay? But we're going to introduce some other field, not just a metric, in order to get something that's non-trivial. How are we going to do this? Well, what? Since this action was a topological invariant, we're going to mess with it. And then we introduce a field, phi, and probably other terms that are going to depend on this scalar field. So now that we've introduced this, this is no longer a topological invariant. We have, besides the metric, we have this scalar field, which we will call the dilaton. And then we can add other terms. We can add terms that, for instance, are terms with gradients of phi, or some terms which are, say, a potential for phi. Okay? So we can have terms like this, and some potential for phi, okay? And depending on how you choose these other terms, then you're going to get a different theory of dilaton gravity. These are theories of dilaton gravity in two dimensions, which is a field, an entire field on its own. There's a review by Daniel Grumiller and collaborators some years ago where they study all of, huge classes of these theories in a lot of generality, okay? Now, maybe some of you know, those of you who know about going between Einstein frame metrics and string frame metrics, you know that when you're in dimensions larger than two, this factor can be absorbed by a change of a conformal frame. And then you go from this thing that you might call the Einstein the string frame to the Einstein frame. In two dimensions, that doesn't work. Okay? If you perform that change of conformal frame, you still get stuck with this. What you're changing is the structure of the other terms. Actually, you can perform a conformal change of frame and eliminate the kinetic term, which is something that's useful. But that's for those of you who know about these things. The rest, you don't need to worry about it for now. Now, if we do this, well, one thing that we notice is that phi is multiplying r. And we know that in gravity, what multiplies r, that's Newton's constant. So we can say that what we're doing is we're introducing an effective Newton's constant that depends on the position. We can say that what we've done is to make the Newton constant position dependent. Okay? And it's an x-dependent gravitational coupling. Of course, so another thing that follows from here is that if we have a black hole, well, in two dimensions, that's one space dimension. If we have a horizon, the horizon will be just a point. What's the area of a point? Well, the area of a point, I would say that it's one, just one, that number. So the entropy of the black hole in two dimensions, what we expect is that it's going to be the area, which is one, divided by this. And then the area, or the entropy of the black hole, is going to be given by the value of the dilaton at the horizon. So the value of the dilaton in these cases, it's going to give us the entropy of the black hole. You may say, how do I know that the area of a point is one and not some other number? Well, what I gave you is kind of a hand-waving quick argument. You can derive this entropy, this formula for the entropy, if you do a Gibbons-Hawking type of analysis, like what we did earlier, you do it for this metric, and then you can derive that actually the entropy that you associate to the horizon will in general be given by this expression. Okay? You do this analysis that we did going Euclidean, localizing close to the horizon, you recover this formula. Okay? Now, another way of motivating all of this is that what's a way to get two-dimensional black holes? Well, you can start with a black hole in more dimensions, say a spherically symmetric black hole. This is a sphere in some dimensions. Then, well, say that I'm just going to consider the dynamics of gravity in the spherically symmetric sector. I'm going to consider only possible fluctuations that preserve the spherical symmetry of the setup. So then it's natural for me to consider this as a two-dimensional metric. And if I'm only considering variations in the size of the sphere, in general, here we will have some function of the radius. I'll make this variable. Then I can call this is a scalar field. So the spherical symmetric sector of a gravity theory in more dimensions, the spherical symmetric sector is going to be described by a 2D gravitational theory plus a scalar. Okay. You can perform the reduction, dimensional reduction, because this sphere, these are cyclic coordinates. I can integrate them out of my equations. I can integrate them out of the action. So if I take the Einstein-Hilbert action in more dimensions, I integrate out the sphere, then what I get is a theory of two-dimensional gravity of this kind, two-dimensional dilaton gravity, where the size of the spheres is given by the dilaton. And this is precisely, so what's the area of this black hole over here? Let me call this to the phi. I call this phi like this. Okay, so this is phi. The exponential is something that's sometimes useful, but it's not what I'm doing here. What's the area of this black hole? The area of this black hole is going to be proportional to the value of the dilaton of this field at the horizon. So this is area proportional to this, so that's why we get this formula over here. So everything seems to be consistent. These 2D dilaton gravities, the way that they often appear is as the spherically symmetric sector of some higher dimensional black hole, of some higher dimensional gravitational theory, when we restrict it, as I say, to spherical symmetry, S wave. And you know, something that you know is that the spherically symmetric sector of gravity, of Einstein gravity, that's trivial. There's no spherically symmetric graviton. There are no sphere gravitational waves. The graviton is spin 2. You only have quadrupolar gravitational waves. There's nothing like a gravitational wave that's purely spherical. There are no propagating degrees of freedom that are spherically symmetric. So these theories won't have propagating degrees of freedom. And these theories, you know, they won't have propagating degrees of freedom, which is something that you can see that the kinetic term, you can eliminate it by a conformal change of frame. Okay. So all of these are different ways of looking at the same system. You can look at your two-dimensional dilaton gravity, in many cases, you can look at it as something that comes from higher dimensions reduced on a sphere. So what, well, here, as I say, up to field redefinitions and changes of conformal frame, there's a huge class of different theories that you can construct. You specify the potential for the field, you specify it to be whatever you want, and then you get a different dilaton gravity theory. So you have to choose the ones which are most interesting. Those are, in general, theories that will have black holes and that have easy solvability. And maybe they can be motivated from a higher dimensional point of view, as I'm saying. But one that's particularly interesting, there's two which are especially interesting. I'm going to mention the two, but later I will focus on just on one. There's one which is called JT gravity for Jakiv and Teitelbaum. Teitelbaum wrote a paper in 83, Jakiv in 85, but somehow people decided to call them in reverse order. So the axiom for Jakiv-Teitelbaum gravity, so this is a solution where we have the dilaton, and we specify the potential and the interactions between the dilaton and the metric to be of a particular kind. So it's a theory like this. That's trivial. Okay. So if you want the potential for the dilaton that I'm choosing is lambda phi. Okay. So it's just one special choice. We're interested in the case of anti-de-Sitter space. So this will be minus 2 over L squared. And I can set always the cosmological constant to the cosmological radius to 1. So Jakiv, Teitelbaum gravity, we often write it like this. Okay. There's another theory that's interesting, but I'm not going to say more about it. It's a theory that appears as the low energy effective axiom of string theory in two dimensions. You don't need to know this origin. You may just want to know that the theory is like this. And you see that it differs. It's different because of the coupling to the dilaton is different. And this changes a lot the properties of the theory. Okay? Very often what we take is this lambda, we write it, take it to be negative, and like this. Sometimes this is called the CGHS theory for Callan, Giddings, Harvey, and Strominger. That's a bit of a misnomer, because what these guys did is to take this theory and then couple it to conformal matter, to a large number of conformal scalars, and then they show that in this case one can consider the quantum, to solve the quantum theory for the scalars and also include the back reaction on the geometry. So that CGHS is this plus conformal matter. But sometimes nowadays more and more people are calling it the CGHS. But the context where this was first found, I think it was string theory in two dimensions. Anyway, this theory, I'm not going to say much. I'm going to say a few things about JT gravity. A few things in 5 minutes. Maybe six. Do we get black holes out of this theory? Do we get interesting black holes? Because after all, we're going to use this. This is a theory that's going to have anti-de Sitter to space. And we're going to see whether we can get, even if the theory has very simple dynamics, can it have black holes, non-trivial black holes? Okay, so we have the theory. We take JT gravity. We want to derive the equations of motion. How do we derive equations of motion? Well, we have to take derivatives of the axion with respect to the dilaton and derivatives of the axion with respect to the metric. Okay. If we take variations of the dilaton, well, this is very simple. We require this And this means that R has to be minus 2. R plus 2 is 0. And in two dimensions, scalar curvature determines Ricci tensor and Riemann tensor. So all of the solution must be a solution that has constant negative curvature. Constant negative curvature in two dimensions, what's that? That's anti de Sitter space. So all solutions, again, they must be locally equivalent to anti de Sitter space in two dimensions. And, well, we've already seen it several times. This is now anti de Sitter space in global coordinates in two dimensions. This is a strip. It's not a cylinder, it's a strip. Time runs like this. R goes to infinity in this direction, and R goes to infinity also in the opposite direction. The center is R equals 0. Lines of constant R are these vertical lines. Okay. We have two, now we have two asymptotic boundaries, which are disconnected points. They are connected through the bulk. This is a model for an internal wormhole, an internal traversable wormhole. You've seen that wormholes, well, you've seen the news, right? You read the news? You know? Okay. We can talk about this at some moment, if you want, later. Yeah. But, so this is just one way of writing anti de Sitter space in two dimensions. If we take, so in this way, for this, well, we chose those polar coordinates for the hyperboloid, but we can also choose coordinates along a boost direction, like we did in three dimensions. And in that case, I'm not doing it explicitly because it's the same thing as we did before. This is another form of anti de Sitter space in two dimensions, but now we have a horizon. This is called Rindler ADS2, sometimes also called thermal ADS2. Now the geometry has a horizon, an acceleration horizon. This is R equals constant. These are orbits of d by dt. So the time here and the time here, they are different. Time here runs between here and that other point. So this is R equals 1. I say, oh, that's great. Then I can do the same thing as before, change identifications of points, and then get a black hole. But then you look at it, and then you say, well, what points do I identify here, since I don't have the x direction to change identifications? So, well, what worked in three dimensions doesn't work. If we want to say that this is a black hole, then we have to do something else. We have to look at it a bit more closely. And then we realize that, well, we're getting the solution for the metric, but we haven't said what happens to the dilaton in these geometries. Okay? We also have to solve the equations for the dilaton. The equation for the metric is, you see that that's something that's quite wonderful here. We've been able to solve for the metric for part of the of our system without saying anything yet about the other part, the dilaton. So what do we get for the dilaton? So this one and this one, they are, what we have to do is the same thing going to the hyperboloid. So it's not, I mean, this R and this, the R anti here are completely different than the ones R anti here. But I don't want to put tildes, hats, or whatever. So say I put them and then I say, well, I now drop them. But what I do is, you want? This is anti de Sitter space in two dimensions. And now I take R anti coordinates as boost coordinates between x0 and x1. I take And if, well, you can verify it, whether I've made it, done it correctly or not, then X1, you call it R. Okay. Whereas these ones are like what we've done in the other cases. So what is the dilaton? In order to determine the dilaton, well, we have to solve the other part of the equations. Yeah, I'm finishing now. I'm going to give you the solution for the dilaton, and then we'll go for our coffee break. So when we vary delta ij, then the equation, I mean, that the equation, by the way, is the equation that the stress tensor for the dilaton is zero. The equations that we find are this box phi. This is, we get these two sets of equations, gij phi. Okay. Well, what you find is that, well, you can have three solutions here. Like we have k equals 1 minus 1. I can put here, I can solve the equations, these equations, for the three forms of ADS2. These are three forms of ADS2. K equals plus 1 is global ADS2. K equals minus 1 is Rindler ADS2. And the third one is Poincaré, which I am not saying anything about. But we can also get it. It's another solution. So you can solve the equation for the dilaton in this matrix for the three values of k. What you find is that in all cases, the solution is given by some constant times r. So this solves the dilaton equations for the three different forms of ADS that we have. But of course, even the solutions are not the same because the meaning of R is different. So R here corresponds, R constant is this, R equals constant here is that, in Poincaré, which covers this, R equals constant is this. Okay. So R is different, which means that the dilaton also is different. It's a different part of a, it's values in anti-Dirichlet space is different. So even if all of these geometries are locally the same, they are all ADS2, what distinguishes between the three forms of anti-Dirichlet space is the value of the dilaton. The dilaton takes different values in each of the black holes. So the dilaton is crucial to say whether the dilaton in the case of global ADS, the dilaton is constant along these lines. Okay? And the dilaton then goes to infinity at the boundaries in global ADS. The dilaton in Rindler ADS is constant along these lines, and then it's only defined in this range. Okay? Because here it goes to infinity. Pi goes to infinity. And in Poincaré, the same thing. So what distinguishes, what makes this a black hole is not identifications of points, as it was in the case of anti-Dirichlet 3. What makes this a black hole is the value of the dilaton. This is what distinguishes this solution from this solution. The metric or the geometries are the same, locally and globally, but the dilaton is different. Okay. The dilaton blows up, and in order to give this system some, so it blows up near the boundary, in order to give this system some dynamics, what one does is introduce a cutoff for the dilaton. One cuts off the boundary of the geometry, and then all of the dynamics of this system is dynamics of the boundary where you fix the dilaton. Okay? So that's what we said a few days ago, that all of the dynamics in ADS2, there's no bulk dynamics. All of the dynamics is dynamics of the boundary. And that boundary dynamics, that corresponds to, well, to this property of the dilaton distinguishing between one solution and the other. And I will stop here, give you a break before we go to the final lecture. Okay? If you have any questions, I'll be here to try to answer them.